Hi, everybody. Welcome to this week's Learning Space Quickies. My name is Nicole Gallucci. I promised you all a brief pre-recorded episode since I will be either running for a plane or boarding a plane at the time of our usual Learning Space show. So I'm going back to a concept we did where I had a short pre-recorded episode that demonstrated some interesting astronomy activity, astronomy education type activity. So I'm going to do that now. Before I left for the American Astronomical Society meeting, I recorded a little bit of the construction process of building an itty-bitty radio telescope. We'd gotten some questions and suggestions about talking about that on the show before, so I thought I'd give you guys a little glimpse of that. To be honest, the video did not come out as well as expected, so I'll try and edit it together a little bit as sensibly as possible. An itty-bitty radio telescope is a system using basically a satellite TV dish from your roof, a friend's roof, somewhere where you could actually take one down safely, and turn that into an instrument that you can use to view or see radio astronomical sources. Well, one radio astronomical source, the sun in particular, it's pretty bright. Even at those particular radio frequencies, you can see the sun. You can see or detect radio interference from cell phones, electronics, and you can also see something interesting, an interesting effect that the ground actually has a bit of radio emission coming from it, in a way that the sky doesn't have. So I'll show you a little bit of video of one of my itty-bitty radio telescopes, pointing at the sun, pointing at the cold sky, pointing at the ground, and getting some signal there. And I'll show you some video of putting it together. It's really simple. You can go to an electronics store to get the parts that you could use to put together. And I found I have four or five of these satellite radio dishes in my garage now. I've all gotten for free, either from friends who were taking them off their property and didn't want them. One of them was actually next to the dumpster at my apartment complex, so I grabbed that. Sites like Craigslist or Freecycle, people will give them away for free or just say, hey, it's outside my house, come get it. So you can pick up a dish completely free. You can get some parts from an electronics store. I'll talk a little bit about that. And you can set up your own demonstrator of a radio telescope. It's not going to be, you know, high quality science, but it's a good activity to teach some basic electronics, some soldering skills, and how a non-visible light telescope works. So I'm going to get into some of the video for that now. Thanks for watching my short video. I am indeed recording in the middle of the night from Seattle Airport. So thank you, Seattle Airport, for having a 24-hour coffee shop and free Wi-Fi. This is actually one of the newer ones. It's got HD capability. It's got several receiver channels. We're only going to be using one receiver channel. And in fact, whoever pulled this off their roof already cut the cable of two of the channels, so those aren't going to be doing much. But you have to have at least one coaxial cable coming out the end for you to get your signal. This one is covered in spider webs, so, you know, be careful when you're pulling things in from the trash. Some other pieces that you're going to need. This is the this is a signal level meter. This is the Channel Master 1004 IFD. You don't need this exact model. This is one of the favorite models, I think, of a lot of the itty-bitty radio telescope makers. They don't make them anymore, but you can find these fairly cheaply on eBay or Craigslist or something like that. But you should feel free to play around with a different signal meter for whatever your purpose is. Some other things you're going to need for this signal meter in particular, and for some others, they don't have their own power source, so you're going to have to make a power source. This is 8 AA batteries in a AA battery case. You can get parts like this at stores like Radio Shack, anywhere they sell radio parts. I literally just stuffed the batteries in there and used some electrical tape to keep it together. So this will come in handy. The way that we'll end up connecting is using one of these 9-volt battery connectors. We're going to do some soldering for that. Make sure you have a soldering iron handy. So I am soldering iron handy, and I should probably get that warmed up. Keep an eye on the dog, make sure she doesn't get too close to it. Some solder. It's a really easy job. You can get flux if you want. I'm not going to bother with this because it's a easy connection. You need two coaxial cables at minimum. One of them has to be 2 feet long. The other one has to be at minimum 4 feet long. But again, that depends on how you're going to be using your itty-bitty radio telescope. You can use heat shrink wrap if you're fancy. I'm going to use electrical tape to cover up some of what I've worked on. A couple of other parts you'll need are these RF chokes. These prevent signal from going back up a line where you don't want signal to go. The instructions that I'm using, these come from the National Radio Astronomy Observatory. They call for an RF choke that has, here it is. It's about 1 to 0.1 megahertz. These didn't have a choice or a label at the store where I got them, so we'll give these a shot and see if these work okay. If you want, you can build, I'm not going to be showing how to build a mount or a tabletop mount for this one. This is just the electrical systems going together. I found this is pretty useful for camp situations, for showing kids how radio telescopes work. If you want something that's a bit more permanent, you want to look into either mounting it on a tripod or getting a table mount, making it out of a Lazy Susan so that you can point it in any direction that you want. That's going to be one of my next things I work on after this one. Okay, skipping the base. I'm going to skip that. These instructions also call for terminating the lines that you're not using. I didn't do that in this model. You can actually take off the receivers and terminate the ones that you're not using. Help reduce some signal loss. Had a hard time actually finding terminating caps. I know I bought a whole bunch the last time I built one of these, and I can't find them either in the house or in the store at the moment. But even without having to add extra terminators, things worked out okay. Okay, so your channel master is going to require 12 volts of input of power, and that's where we get our 8 AA batteries for that. In order to get that going, you need to take one of your coax cables, the shorter one, and cut off one of the ends of it. I chose this one because the end had already started to break off, so what I'm going to do is just cut along the cable and cut off the connector end. These are quite literally my kitchen shears, but you should probably use a wire cutter if you can find them. There we go. All right. So you've cut the end off a coaxial cable, and what you see on the inside is you have a copper conductor in the very center. Let's see if my camera will actually focus on that. You have a copper conductor in the very center. It's not doing a very good job. Surrounded by white insulating material, surrounded by some more metal material, and surrounded once more by the black insulating material. So you're going to strip off about 2 inches of this black insulator material, but being careful not to ruin the metal mesh underneath. So I am using just a knife here. You can use wire strippers, wire cutters, whatever you're comfortable with. Remember, if you're doing this with your kids, you might want to keep the sharp tools to yourself. Depends on how well you trust them with sharp tools and materials. I have, in fact, been corrected, let's say, by my coworkers when I've done stupid things that could have cut off a thumb. Okay, so I kind of peeled that off like that. Okay, so now you see you've removed the black insulation, or whatever color rubber you have on the outside, and this still kind of sticky metal braiding, as well as metal layer of conductor is around that.
Okay.
So now what you're going to do is pull apart this wire braiding a little bit so that you can make that sort of one wire. So you're going to pull that all the way down to make sort of one single wire. Okay, so that's that outer metal braiding there. You've made a wire out of that. Next, you're going to very carefully peel off this foil layer without breaking or removing the white insulation underneath. Now, you want to remove about an inch of this white insulator material, exposing the copper wire inside. Again, being careful not to cut through or break or score that copper wire. Again, sometimes pliers will help remove that insulation, leaving you with a nice bit of copper, about an inch long. There. Okay, so now you want your RF choke. If you have one that already has a wire going through it, you solder the end of that wire to this copper. This one doesn't, so I need to put the copper through it. As you can see, I didn't quite cut enough off, so I'm going to have to cut off some more of this insulation.
Okay.
So now you've got your coax with your copper wire, your braiding, which has been kind of rolled together into another wire, and your RF choke, preventing any signal going back and forth. You're going to attach this to your 9-volt battery connector. The red line is going to be soldered to the copper, and the black, or the ground, is going to be soldered to your braiding here. So next thing you want to do is protect all of this exposed metal you have. And that's where you can, if you've put a big old honking piece of heat shrink wrap, you would do that. Because this RF choke's really big, I would just use some electrical tape to go all around it. Make it red. I think the dog is bored. Okay, so this big old mess here is your power connector. So again, your power supply is your 8 AA batteries in a AA battery case. And you can use the 9-volt connector to connect to that. Oops. Just the way you would a regular 9-volt battery. Okay, so now you get your channel master, your signal meter, and you get the power to it by using the other end of this, power adapter that you've made, and screwing that into the input that says LNB. So now you get your big old dish, and you plug that into the side that says SAT-RX, so satellite receiver. So now you can use the dial or the noise that this is making to tell you how strong the signal is. As the signal gets stronger, the signal noise gets to a higher pitch. Now I'm going to turn this on inside. There's lots of things in this house that give off radio frequencies, and so what you're going to get is a signal. Big surprise. What's most interesting, of course, is when you take it outside. But let's just test it inside first. Whoop, that's working. And I'm gonna hope you can hear this. It's the signal from the channel master for the Itty Bitty Radio Telescope. And it points at hot ground. Get signal. Cold sky. Sun. Oh, I'm so excited. So excited. I hope you enjoyed that little how-to on how to build an itty-bitty radio telescope. Do follow the link in the show notes for more instructions, particularly instructions that I used to build mine, but there are lots of different ways of kind of putting it together, different parts. We may be wondering what I'm talking about at the end there with hot ground and cold sky and what the heck that has to do with radio waves. So I'm going to save that for a future episode, because if I try and explain that at 2 a.m. in the middle of an airport, it's just going to be a mess. So thanks for watching this Learning Space Quickie. We'll be back with a regular episode starting next week.